Hi, my name is Shaddy Zayour, and today we're going to be covering an all-new evolution to our access side of the house, and that is adaptive access in a zero-trust world. And we'll see how our zero-trust offering or play has now evolved into including an all-new adaptive access experience. So to talk about this, we're going to introduce zero-trust, establish a baseline, and how that relates to an identity-centric perspective. We'll introduce intelligent adaptive access, what that really means, how that can help you and your organization. I'll also introduce Interset, which is what's driving a lot of this and on a lot of these processes, as well as give you some example use cases so that you can see how this will benefit you and your organization as you look to provide an adaptive access experience. So what is Zero Trust? Well, it's a pretty basic concept. It's been around for a really long time, but here at Microfocus, we look at this really from an identity-centric role. So we don't assume trust, right? We have the ability to maintain strict controls around every access point, around every application, how users gain access to an application, and how we keep their access in check over time. We don't want to trust anyone or anything by default. We don't want to leave their access over time. Once they're done using that access, we should remove it and really keep that access in line with principle of least privilege, which is here at the bottom. So we only want to grant access to what's needed, nothing more, nothing less. And to enable to do that, in order to do that, we leverage things like context. We understand who users are, what they're accessing, and why they're accessing that. So where this goes now, or where Zero Trust has been evolving to, is really combining Zero Trust with the ability to do user entity behavior analytics and combining that with access controls. So we want to define policy based on previous access patterns for things like how an identity has used an application, what device are they typically accessing from, or what is their behavior when they interact with an application. Now, it's extremely difficult to do this manually. Rule-based systems are dead, and that's really a quote directly from Forrester. You can't define what you don't know, right? And that really becomes very complex and complicated, where if you're looking to do kind of individual-based policy where you have things adapting over time, that sounds like it could be potentially a lot of work. But through this presentation, we'll show you how a lot of this will be automated, and we'll do automatic baseline building. That way you can do things like anomaly detection, identifying risk, and kicking off downstream processes that respond to that risk measurement. So let's go ahead and dive into how we're adding intelligence to adaptive access. So in order to do that, let's first talk about where we started. So we started with static access controls, and this is where our solution and the entire industry started. Think of this as your typical static policy. Then we moved into contextual access. This is where we're looking at things like context, such as IP addresses, locations, and devices. We've been doing this. The industry has evolved to this over time. Now, where we're getting into is now called behavioral adaptive access. And that's something that's tailored to an individual user's behavior. This means less predefined rules, which means less initial overhead, less resources you have to throw at it initially. And we learn and adapt as we go. These types of policies change over time as your organization changes. Perhaps you acquire a new organization, right? Your user base changes, the way your identities access the system changes, the applications they access changes. All of those things can be attributed to different behavioral changes, and as a result, behavioral policies change as well. So the goal here is really to only inconvenience the user when it's necessary, and we do that by combining static, contextual, and behavioral adaptive access. Let's look at this from a little bit different of a perspective. So we consider this to be really three different flavors of risk. The first one being risk at rest. So let's consider what permissions the identity has and what's the sensitivity of those applications. Next, what we've been doing and what we've been enhancing is called risk at context. And this is really things like, is the user accessing from a known device or location, right? What's the context? What is their history kind of in using those types of contextual pieces of information? We look at all those things combined score. Now, what we've evolved to is risk in motion or behavioral risk, right? Is the account being compromised? Is the application being breached? Let's look at their behavior and really correlate that to how they've acted in recent times and really start to understand, has there been elevation in risk? Has this been an abnormal behavior? So we're leveraging UEBA to analyze and identify abnormal behavior by having visibility into the identity and the application that they're trying to access in order to get to the data. Because at the end of the day, attackers are really trying to get to the data that's underlying all of these different applications. So we're able to understand all that by looking at these three different flavors of risk. Now, to put that in a different perspective, this is how this really all comes together. So you're seeing here static risk, risk at rest, context, and behavioral risk. Well, behavioral risk is really the focus of this presentation because that's what really is driving more of the intelligent processes. So we're combining all of these different factors, consuming that into our risk engine in order to do things downstream in order to provide the right access experience as it relates to that user's current risk. So let's take a few different examples here of applications we can integrate to within our IAM portfolio. So first, Access Manager or Advanced Authentication, excuse me. So Advanced Authentication, let's identify, do we need to do things like step up auth? Do we need to ask for a second factor or maybe multiple factors? Do we need a chain, a method of factors in order to prove that this identity is who they say they are, right? Next, in something like Access Manager or Secure API Manager, let's deny or allow access to specific applications based on their risk, or let's allow or deny an API call, right? We're getting into a world where many organizations are using web services and integrating applications via REST. Well, we have an access solution for that as well. Secure API Manager is managing all of those different calls and identifying with the risk engine if that's a necessary call that should be made, risk factors. And then lastly, Privilege Account Manager, let's enable or disable privilege commands and credentials. So again, the goal here is really to only inconvenience the user when necessary. Another really great example is, you know, integrating with the risk engine and Interset to be able to identify, is the user's risk too high? Well, let's disable their access, and then we'll also kick off an identity governance access review. So that way we can analyze their access and immediately revoke access if needed, and we're getting in front of the attack in that way, right? We're really identifying their behavior, what they're trying to access, and kicking off a fulfillment activity so the right user can respond and remove their access if needed. So let me show you a little bit of the behind the scenes work of how this really comes together. So this is an example of Anne, and she's working at an unusual hour for her. So you'll notice the theme behind this is individual based. So this on its own is not really an event that you need to pay attention to, but as we add on these different events, you'll see the risk score being elevated. So VPNing from China, accessing repositories that she and her peers do not usually access, takes a folder on a repository on an unusual number for that particular folder, and then significantly moves a high volume of data that's normal for her, right? So let's first, avoid all the other noise that's going on in the environment. And what this is doing is really helping you identify what you should be paying attention to. So not only, again, like we're doing what I showed in the slide before, not only are we telling you what you should be paying attention to, we can also plug into the IAM solutions in the environment to provide a fulfillment activity for, you know, do we need to remove access? Do we need to ask for step up auth while she's doing all these different things? So again, this is specified to Anne. We're understanding what Anne typically does and elevating the risk as it relates to Anne and not just every user in the environment. So how does this really work? Right, we're identifying the contextual data. We're plugging in, in order to do that, we're plugging into all the different systems in your environment, whether it's repositories, endpoints, you have a SIEM solution, we can integrate with that. You have a data lake, we can integrate with that. Right, so ingesting data and information from all the applications in your environment. When we do that, we correlate and establish a baseline for individual users. And then when users' activity looks malicious or looks to be a little bit riskier, we detect that. And then we plug into our downstream IAM solutions like multi-factor, Access Manager, or IGA for kicking off an access review. So that's kind of how that flow kind of comes together, and that's how that is made possible. So in summary, we're adding intelligence to analyze behavior analytics which is allowing you to get in front of the threat. So we're doing things like detecting malicious insiders by detecting anomalous behavior. We're detecting if an account has been compromised or an application has been compromised because we're able to look at login events and the behavior that's going on those particular applications. We're providing a risk-based experience, and then we can continually authenticate and continually provide an access control around the user accessing that environment or that application, as well as providing an ease-of-use experience, right? So there's not a lot of overhead that goes into this. User entity behavior analytics and adaptive access is really a solution. You stand up, feed it information, and it has all the algorithms and things like that embedded so that we can start doing things like anomaly detection and then also plug into downstream systems in order to provide you the kind of that full adaptive experience from not only detecting but also taking action. So that is where Micro Focus is going with adaptive access, and hope you enjoyed today's presentation. Please let us know if you have any questions, and we'll be happy to answer. Thank you.